This is the first time in my life that I give a lecture of which I know practically nothing. And I hope you will bear with me. It was very nice to hear the introduction by Jesus, because he said roughly the same. But he was doing well. So here is Models and Methods in Cointegration. That was the title given to me. And I have changed it slightly, but hoping to keep to the idea of the lecture. I was fortunate that 2 months ago, I heard a lecture by a philosopher on positivism and metaphysics, which I immediately translated into methods and models. And that's what my first part of the lecture is on. Yes. So here is a summary of the lecture. The lecture on philosophy started with a paper that I should also start with. It's called The Deluge. Data Deluge Makes the Scientific Method Obsolete. Listen, I spent almost 60 years of my life working with the scientific method, so I feel slightly provoked by this statement. The idea is not to criticize the point of view, but perhaps to find some sort of compromise. All models are wrong, but some are useful. This is the quotation marks means that this is from the paper, and the paper is written by Chris Anderson, 2008, in a journal called The Wired Magazine. And if you Google that one, you find a version of the paper with lots of pictures and advertising and things. So I have a copy with only 2 pages where I've left that out. Anyway, the first claim is, first quotation is, so proclaims statistician George Box 30 years ago, and he was right. But what choice did we have? Only models from cosmological equations to human behavior seem to be able to consistently, if imperfectly, to explain the world around us, until now. Today, companies like Google, which have grown up in an area of massively abundant data, don't have to settle for wrong models. Indeed, they don't have to settle for models at all. Now that is provoking, and I will spend time on that. And this is Chris Anderson. He was the chief editor until 2012, and he wrote this paper. I have a copy if anybody wants. Later down the paper, he quotes Peter Norvig, who is the Google Research Director, for saying all models are wrong, but increasingly you can succeed without them. And here is now a very nice statement to which I agree completely. It describes what the scientific method is. It's built around testable hypotheses. Models for the most systems are systems visualized in the mind of a scientist. That's where the metaphysics comes in, right? It's all happening up here. The models are then tested. Experiments confirm or falsify theoretical models on how the world was. This is the way science has worked for hundreds of years. Scientists are trained to recognize that correlations is not causation, that no conclusions could simply be drawn on the basis of correlation between X and Y. It could be just a coincidence. I think if we write spurious instead of coincidence, we agree on this statement. Instead, you must understand the underlying mechanisms that connect the two. Once you have a model, you can connect the data sets with confidence. Data without model is just noise. That may be overdoing it, but that's what it says. But faced with massive data, this approach to science, hypothesize, model, test, is becoming obsolete. Now, that's something one can discuss. Is there a better way now? Petabytes that's large sets of data, big data, allows us to say correlation is enough. We can stop looking for models. We can analyze the data without hypothesize about what it might show. We can throw data numbers into the biggest computer clusters in the world has ever seen, and let statistical algorithms find patterns where science cannot. And then he goes on, he has many examples. The conclusion is clear, there is no reason to cling to our old ways. It is time to ask, what can science learn from Google? Now, that requires a response. So this lecture is about methods and models, which is a topic that I have always been extremely interested in, and which I think the lectures we've heard so far illustrate extremely well. Let me be precise. A method, I mean an algorithm. Any big data set algorithm is a method. Least squares is a method. And you can name anything you want there. What is models? Well, I find that the most important aspect of a model is that we need it to explain our understanding of what is going on. We need the models to be able to talk to each other, to communicate, and we need the models to construct thought experiments, new thought experiments, and also new real experiments that can further our understanding of what is going on. We formulate models. Many models are formulated in econometrics with the purpose of finding properties of the estimators. Show that an estimator is consistent. That has no meaning unless you have an underlying probability measure. That's the model. However, you also construct models to derive new algorithms. The one that is in the title of the whole conference is Cointegration. Once you write delta x is alpha, beta, prime, and dot, 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 then you can start estimating alpha and beta, and that is a new algorithm if you want. So what is the interplay between methods and models? Are models really obsolete, as they claim? Do the big revolution, data revolution, try to solve the same problems as before? Or do they attack new problems that we can never dream of? This, in a sense, is my conclusion for the big data discussion. They have so much data, they can take up new problems that we could not touch before. That's fine. But when it comes to the methodology, I'm a little more skeptical. And we have seen many examples of that now. Now, there is one analog that you must keep in mind when you discuss models, and that is a map. Going from the hotel to here this morning, I got a map of Madrid. And like most maps, it is wrong in the sense it doesn't represent reality completely, but it was relatively useful, I would say. Slightly more useful map would have the name of all streets. But you could imagine a map for traveling Spain through the big cities and see all the wonderful aspects of Spain would be a useless map in this circumstance and an extremely useful map under other circumstances. And models have the same property. A model should not be a mimicking reality. It should be a simple picture of reality where you would draw out the important aspects and model these and leave out unimportant aspects. And you can easily say, as Box did, all models are wrong. The worst model you can imagine is a one-to-one map with reality. I mean, how can you ever communicate that to anyone? It struck me when discussing this that you often have a GPS, and behind the GPS is a little collection of electrons that keep the complete information of all maps in Europe. There is no way you want to look at that. So what does Google do when they want to tell us something? Well, they produce a little square or rectangle with a yellow line indicating what road you're on, and an arrow indicating which direction you are on, and then sometimes a crossing road. Okay, the most primitive of all maps, but it's a fantastically useful map under this circumstance. So even Google, with all these petabytes of data, would use simple maps to communicate with us. Okay. So here are the first half of the lecture, half in some vague sense, is an attempt to discuss what is the interplay between models and methods, and I've chosen three examples. The first one you know, I'm just using it anyway, the next one you may not know, and the last one you probably haven't never seen before. So you might learn something. There will then be another session after these three where I try to talk about cointegration and big data. Gauss and least squares. here is a few statements from the book by Anders Hald called The History of Mathematical Statistics from 1750 to 1930. He stopped at 1930 because that was when Fisher took over and he said that's too complicated. So this is the story of mathematical statistics up to but not including Fisher. And Hald writes there that Gauss used the least squares first time as a young man to calculate the orbit of a planet, Ceres, which is circling the sun. It has a size of 1,000 kilometers, so it's a very small planet. And he saw where it was, and then he predicted that half a year later it would be over there, and it was over there, and he became very famous for that. It's interesting, 200 years later, if you Google Ceres, you will find a nice little movie where NASA has put in all the pictures they have of Ceres, so you can actually fly around the planet of Ceres and look at it. Gauss claims that he used least squares from 1795, and Legendre published it in 1806, and then Gauss published it also in 1809 without mentioning Legendre, and that was the creation of a fight, as usual. But then Hald summarizes the situation after he has done all his very meticulous work about what actually happened in these papers that people wrote. Then Hald permitted himself to come up with some guesses. And he says, likewise, we guess that Gauss, who since 1795 had been using the non-probabilistic principle of least squares, that's a method for fitting equations to data, he chose the data proportional to, and then the usual stuff, because of its mathematical simplicity and its agreement with his method of estimation, and I'll come back to what that means precisely, and only afterward did he provide a proof. The next slide will be on this, but just to summarize, the method is the method of least squares, which you can just invent out of nowhere, and it has to do with geometry and projections and planes, and it's all very intuitive. The model is the Gaussian distribution. You can do least squares without ever having heard anything about the model, obviously, and vice versa. This is from least squares to the normal distribution. Gauss used the least squares before he used the normal distribution. And he asked the following question. Suppose you have a location model, and you can see I've written the log density of xi minus mu, summed of I. This would be the log likelihood in our days. Likelihood was invented much later, so he calls it a maximum or posterior probability, but he also chose the uniform. So in fact, it is the likelihood function. And then he asked, the maximum posterior estimator should be the average. So what distribution has the property that in a location model you get the average as the maximum likelihood estimator? That he solved and published in 1809. And you can see the proof is completely trivial because you take that line there and the derivative of log f you call g, and then of course the line that we have here with the fourth line from the bottom says that the sum of the d log f at xi minus x bar is equal to 0. This has to be true for all x's, So I first use that x1 equal to u and x2 equal to minus u, because then the average is zero. And then I see that g of u is an only an, change the sign with u. Then I do the same with 3 points, and I differentiate, and I see immediately that the derivative of u is a constant, which means that g itself is linear, which means that f, log f is quadratic. And then, of course, you have to normalize and all that. And that means that the method of least squares, here simplified with the average, the method and the model of a location model implies the Gaussian distribution. So the model is actually constructed after the method. Once you have the Gaussian distribution, you can rederive least squares, of course. But now there is a complete concordance between the two methods. Now, a totally different approach and problem was solved by R.A. Fisher. He was working with his agricultural experiments in Rothamsted. And I'm just sort of things, these things that I've heard about many, many times. And I even took a day course with David Cox once on this. Fisher would say the following. You have three fields. And inside a field, you measure four times or four squares the yield of a certain effect of a fertilizer in the first column, more fertilizer in the second, and most fertilizer in the last one. And he wants to find out if it helps fertilize, obviously. And he says, if it doesn't help fertilize, then I would calculate the sum of squares of the deviations of the column sums. And then he was a genius, so he also found out what would be the variance inside these, that is the variation inside each of the columns. He would add that up, that would be my S2. He said, let us look at S1 over S2, that is his statistic. So the algorithm, the method, is completely clear. There is no model so far. Then he had this idea that if there is really no difference between these columns, then you can permute the numbers and put them out in any number, any order you want. If you do that for all possible combinations, you get for each of them a value of S1 divided by S2. And by drawing the histogram, you can see the one you have actually found, where is that? If that's an outlier, your null hypothesis is rejected. So the algorithm is clear. He could see immediately that S1 over S2 is what you want to calculate. And no model. The model, the probability model, is derived from an invariance property. Only when you have done all that, he, of course, proved that in the limit, these S1 over S2 could be approximated with chi-square distributions. And in fact, if you let the x's be Gaussian, you can derive likely ratio tests and go exactly the same. So again, the method is there, and the model is a backup using the Gaussian distribution, which allows you to derive the method. So again, there's a complete harmony between the two. Okay, the last example is a little more complicated. Maybe, no, that's okay. Yeah, that's fine. When I worked studying statistics back in the 50s, 60s, then the item analysis was the big thing. We all knew that Fisher had done a two-way analysis of variance, where the expectation is decomposed in a row effect and a column effect. That would be similar to what I had before. Rasch was looking at, Georg Rasch and his co-workers were looking at another problem in educational statistics. You have N students, and you give them M tests, and you score each test as right or wrong, and everybody would calculate the number of good answers for the students and the number of correct answers for the test. So the algorithm is trivial and clear from the outset. The method is just this sum and that sum, no problem. But is that a good algorithm? No, I claim. He managed to devise a very, very clever algorithm in the following way. I write here the row and column scores give the ranking, or the grades, if you want, of the students. This is something we all do when we grade exams, period. We, of course, construct the exam questions so the students have a chance of doing them, often with completely incorrectly. That's what we do. And they reflect not in a binary vision, but there is this PISA investigation, which I think is throughout the whole Europe, where you look at how children do calculations and read, and that would be tests constructed using these methods. There is a problem. The problem is that if, for some reason, you manage to give the three exercises, which are completely identical in level of difficulty, then all the students answer everything and say, wait a minute, they all have maximum grade, that doesn't mean they're all equally good. So the grading you get from the score here depends on, in a very complicated way, on what type of questions you ask them. And any comparison of students would have to take into account how difficult, how different are the tests. And this raises, sorry, we should go like this. Nope, I should not go like that. Oh. Nope. Help. What do we do? Have I pressed something wrong?
Something.
Now you can move your
robot. Ah, okay, I can do that, yes. Okay, here now is the model that Rasch suggested. These are binary variables. Fischer would use ordinary real variables in his two-way analysis of variance. These are binary variables. So you have to specify the probability of giving a correct answer. Now, this looks a little complicated, but basically what it says, it is a product of two factors, one from the rows and one from the columns, one from the student and one from the test. And in order to make mathematical sense of that, you have to divide 1 plus this one. This is now a number between 0 and 1. This is the probability description. I include that on the right-hand side, a certain coefficient that I don't need. You can see that the joint density is in line 3. That's the probability of getting a given matrix with zeros and ones. You assume independence. Each entry has different probabilities depending on the alpha and the beta in this way. And if you work it out, you can see that it is an exponential of a sum where the alpha I is multiplied by the row sum. And the beta j is multiplied by the column sum. And then this awful constant at the bottom. So here is a very nice explanation of the obvious algorithm. You take the row and column sums. They are what we call the sufficient statistics. So this model tells you that, yes, in fact, the algorithm of doing row and column sums makes a lot of sense. I have now three lines which are a little more complicated. I want to derive the distribution of the row sums and the column sums. That's the middle line there. Now, that, of course, is proportional to what we just had because they all have the same probability. So in front there with the m whatever is by combinatorial coefficient. Imagine you have an m by n matrix with given rows and columns, and you ask, how many matrices can you form that has that? That's the m. Now we know what it is, and we can forget it. We don't want to calculate that. In the 50s and 60s, that was an issue, but it's, of course, not an issue now. Okay, so I derive the joint density or distribution of the rows and columns, R and C are vectors, and the marginal distribution of the row sums. And then comes something that he almost made into a religion, namely the conditional distribution of the column sums given the row sums only depends on one set of parameters. And then he said, ah, wait a minute, now we can do maximum likelihood in the conditional likelihood. And then that would give a transformation of the column sums into the betas. And that means you can make inference on the betas completely independent of the parameters corresponding to the alphas. And he even called it specific objectivity, which was, made a big thing out of this. But basically, this is sufficient statistics and conditional distributions are often what you have to do in this sort of. So what he did was he actually improved the obvious algorithm from just taking sums into calculating the maximum likelihood estimators of these parameters, which are concepts that allow you to define the quality of a student and the quality of a test. Oh, you can do this. Okay, so the conditional distribution is here, and then you transform the immediate score C into a modified score beta J, and then you can make inference on the exercise or the tests independently of the estimates of the students. So by building a careful statistical model, we can create concepts, and these are the alphas and the betas, which can be used to express our understanding of the world. I mean, these betas are the grades. So if we want to grade our students, this is how you do it. And we can communicate to each other, because once you have this, you can construct an algorithm for estimating it. So again, it's an example where you have a model, you have a method. Watch out, the modified method comes from analyzing the model, not from somewhere. So in this case, the model had the nice property that it actually helped you get a better algorithm than the one you had before. So let's see now. Yeah. So this is fine. This is the first part of the lecture, and it's about models and methods. And I just want to analyze what is it we lose if we don't have a model. Let me point out that let's see now. Whatever method, say you take in cointegration, you do the Phillips type regression, and then you say, we'll just run regression. And you say, we'll make a model. We'll say that this is I1 and this is I1 and this is IID or whatever. And then we analyze the method. We find out the method is not so good. That was the Engel-Granger regression. That doesn't quite work. And then Philip said, we have to do something. Then he constructs another algorithm by correcting the variables for the long-run variance. And now we have it. So he took a probability model and used it to analyze an algorithm. He realized that the result was not satisfactory, and then he said, sort of on intuitive ground, well, you have to correct this using the long-run variance, and then you get a better algorithm. There is no derivation of a method from the model in this case. If you go to the classical cointegrative R model, alpha, beta prime, and Gaussian errors and all that, then, in fact, by doing maximum likelihood, you derive an algorithm that is, well, we will see that, sometimes useful for the inference. So models have many properties, and I think before you throw them all away, you should be aware of what you are throwing away. And I'm just giving you a few examples where it probably wouldn't be a good idea. Okay, cointegration in big data, that was what we were really doing, and of course, I end up with two topics. One is cointegration on Hilbert space, and the other one is simultaneous asymptotics in cointegration, which has been mentioned already by two people. I went to Rome 2 weeks ago and talked to Massimo Franchi, and he's working on cointegration in Hilbert space. And the first paper that came out is by Chan, King, Kim, and Park. And they basically, here's a very simple example. You take a big population like the Spanish population, take the income of everybody and follow that income over time. So that's a distribution of a histogram over time. Well, they are ambitious, so they use kernel estimation, so you actually get a density over time. Now that density is an infinite dimensional object. If you say it's on a compact set, which I guess modern finance indicates that it is not compact. But let's say that you have a compact set for your income, then the square integral of functions, f, gives you a Hilbert space. You should think of a Hilbert space as basically R to the n, except goes on like a series. And you can define linear functions by these sort of operator g, operate simply by integrating the product. And you can define operators operating on the Hilbert space, you plug in a continuous function, you get out a new continuous function. That's what I call A sub K. What is K? K is the kernel. So you take a kernel, and you take plug in a function f, integrate it back to the kernel, and you get out another function, then you have a linear mapping of the Hilbert space onto itself. And then they use, they can discuss IID Gaussian variables, they can discuss random walks, and then they had a method of calculating eigenvalues. They called it functional principal components, but it's sort of basically a variation of the finite dimensional thing. And then they do asymptotic analysis. And then Beer and Seu and Franchi and Parolo, they consider a similar setup, but they have the ambition of finding autoregressive processes. So again, here's this operator A that you plug in a continuous function, you get out a continuous function. And then you have to be very careful here. These operators are rather complicated, and these, they discuss operators that have unit roots of finite type. Now, that, I don't know what that is, but it means that in these models, you want a finite number of common trends and an infinite number of cointegration relations. That's an assumption. If you do that, you can do the whole I1, I2, I3 theory and get brain representation and everything. It's very nice. And now comes in the last topic, which is the paper by Onatsky and Wong that has been mentioned by a number of people. They have a fantastic result. It's a nice little paper, 24 pages, but that's only till you realize that there is an appendix, which is 85. And the proof, the real proof, is the 80 pages. This is a fantastic piece of work. Anyway, they're considering the usual problem. And then they want to go to the limit in a totally, completely, utterly different way. And I'll show you some of the results. P is the dimension, T is the number of observations, and you want P and T to be proportional, which is very difficult to think about. You also want R to go to zero when you divide it by P. So R is a very small component compared to P. So in a certain sense, these people allow, if you want a finite number of cointegrating relations and an infinite number of random common trends. So it's exactly the opposite. And then they have a condition which says that all the gammas, the extra matrices you need, remember this is a P by PK matrix, and all the gamma matrices I've ever seen in my life that would have full rank. Therefore, the condition that when you divide by P, the rank goes to zero, is not, in my opinion, a reasonable condition. However, we should not discuss conditions. Think about the baby model where k is equal to zero. You just have alpha, beta, prime. Then the only condition is that p and t are proportional, and r goes to zero with p. I was hoping I could explain to you what the result is. Those of you who know the theory of the trace tests and all this will realize that the upper matrix there, the D, I call it DF for Dickey Fuller matrix, is exactly the one that appears in the trace test, except I have divided it by P, the dimension. Okay, so here are some simple, well-known facts. If R is zero and P is fixed, that's what we have worked on all the time, then the lambdas go to zero. The lambdas of the usual eigenvalue problem on top. Okay, if you multiply them with T, then you get convergence. In fact, they become, in the limit, random eigenvalues of DF, except for the factor P. Okay, so you can divide by P throughout that equation. Doesn't change anything. And then it tells you that you take the lambdas, not the test statistic, the eigenvalues, multiply by T to make them nice, divide by P to normalize them somehow, then you get exactly the eigenvalues of the matrix on top there. So still random, the convergent distribution to random variables. And then we define the empirical distribution function of those right there. This is the empirical distribution function of that. Empirical distribution function usually converts to a real one, and what is the distribution of that? That is the distribution of an eigenvalue converges, so in this very precise sense. And here it is in the middle, the third line. This is the empirical distribution function of the usual lambdas we discuss in the eigenvalue. We sum over p terms and divide by p, because that's how you do with empirical distribution functions. And the limit exists. And I want to show it to you before I give you the formula. I want you to show what it looks like. This is a simulation where the upper simulation you have p equal to 20. That is a pretty big system. You have 80 observations, which is a pretty small sample size. You calculate these eigenvalues. They are eigenvalues of 20 by 20 matrices. And you do it, 10,000 times, I think. And you get the upper picture. Now, there are two things you should notice. First of all, it looks as if there is nothing happening from 0.85 to 1 and from 0 up to some small number. There are no eigenvalues there. Okay, we don't believe that, so we increase the sample size by multiplying by 20. So now we have 1,600 observations. Observations. And p, our nice little alpha, beta, prime meter, is now 400 by 400. And then 10,000 times, you find the eigenvalues of a 1,000 by 1,000 matrix, make a histogram, and then you get that nice curve there. And now it's pretty obvious that even though we haven't been off to infinity yet, there is distinctly a zero to the left and a zero to where nothing happens, and then the bulk of a sort of a strange sort of bell-shaped thing. And here's the curve. It's called the Wachter distribution, because Wachter discussed eigenvalues and matrices. And it has this strange form. You notice x times 1 minus x is this function. But since you cut it off, it doesn't really matter. It is like a beta distribution on top when you sort of push it down at the bottom. So you get, here is the picture of it. Again, the Wachter distribution, here's the theoretical density, and this is for one quarter. So P, the dimension of the matrix, is one quarter of the number of observations. Not a system you would normally work with. Okay. And then, this is a little tricky, but let me just show that by going to the limit with the Wachter distribution, you get a special case called the Marchenko-Pasteur distribution, and that has a formula, as you can see at the bottom. And that gives you the limit of the distribution of the ordinary eigenvalues we know from the cointegrating list. And then this likelihood ratio test, testing rank equal to zero, dimension p, number of observation t, divided by p squared. You can write that as t over p, which is our ratio t, multiplied by this animal, and it converges to 2. That's the 90-page proof, or 80-page proof. And then Gonzalo and Pitarakis in 95 showed that, by simulations, that the likelihood ratio test is 2p squared plus 1, I think they call it, but by simulations. And here's the result, as Jesus mentioned. I was also involved, but that doesn't matter so much. And then I want to show you a conjecture they're doing, which is sort of full circle, because if you look at, if you look at this one, like a ratio statistic, divided by p minus 2p, and simply find the 90% quantile from the asymptotic distribution. And divide by p and subtract 2p. It's a very simple transformation. So the two columns, 40.1783, is just the quantiles, and you can find them in the usual tables of the trace test. And the other one is a simple linear transformation using these asymptotic results. So there's nothing happening here, except if you look at the second column, you can imagine it going down there. 2.04, 1.99, it goes on to 1.92, so it converges. And their conjecture is that this limit is a Gaussian distribution. So we are full circle now, namely that the trace test in a different type of asymptotics is essentially a Gaussian distribution around a mean with a variance. That is undone, unfinished work, so another 90 pages it will come. Thank you very much. That was all I wanted to say.